Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Subtle Energy, a Handbook of Psychic Energy Manipulation by Keith Miller. Narrated by Noah Michael Levine. Preface. The direct manipulation of subtle energy is a way to affect one's influence on the world and to perform a variety of psychic feats, such as telepathy, clairvoyance, and so on. Though often regarded as a modern approach to magical systems with a relatively short history, direct manipulation of subtle energies has been a part of magical practices and systems across cultures since as long as these things have been documented. What has changed, what is new to the approach in this current era, is our application of scientific rather than spiritual or philosophical terminology to this kind of work. Today, we speak of manipulation of energy in modern terms, with mental imagery of waves, forces, and particles. Another relatively recent convention is the manipulation of subtle energy as a goal unto itself. Historically, in most magical systems in both the East and the West, there has been an awareness and acknowledgement of subtle energy as a factor in magical work, but this has generally been regarded as a medium or mechanism by which an effect is carried out. The aim was not to manipulate the energies, but rather to bring about the desired result, with subtle energy being considered more of a medium or a vehicle than an agent of the activity. The focus on subtle energy work as a goal unto itself is indeed a fairly modern convention, though it does not seem to be one that is going away, nor does it lack merit simply because it is new. Still, it is important to consider why people work with subtle energy itself, what they are aiming to achieve, or what they are avoiding, and how this particular work has its own benefits and shortcomings. It is the opinion, perhaps not entirely unfounded, of many magicians of the more ritualistic sort, that energy work as such is merely a shortcut, and one that tends to bring about inferior results. Energy workers answer by saying that they have merely removed the unnecessary and tedious steps of the ritual and choose to bring about the result themselves, directly. But this kind of antagonistic relationship does not need to be the case. There are applications for which subtle energy work itself is very well suited, and there are applications where it can be used to enhance or inform the sorcerer's work on either a theoretical or practical level. Energy workers and sorcerers alike would do well to learn from the other systems rather than jump into immediate criticism. After all, there is plenty to criticize based on the merits without making implicit assumptions of other people's ways of working. I will be aiming to address with this book what I have learned in my 18 years of engagement with subtle energy manipulation, a term that has not always been consistently used, but which is, I believe, the most accurate for what I will discuss. Over the years, I have heard it referred to as psionics, psychic energy manipulation, psychoenergetics, psi manipulation, energy work, and a number of other terms, and I've used a number of these terms myself. I have chosen to adopt the term subtle energy because it fits without carrying with it as much baggage. It has its own baggage to be sure, but it's baggage that I keep my clothes in, so to speak. Subtle energy addresses nicely the Hermetic concepts that I use as my working philosophical basis. It avoids overly materialistic scientific language, which I find the wrong tool for the job, and it establishes immediately a contrast between subtle energy and the less subtle sorts. It also avoids using terms from other fields, whereas psychic energy is a term of art in psychology, which relates to how much mental energy a person has to engage in cognitive processes, the exhaustion of which leads to the deployment of various ego defenses. So, the term subtle energy avoids the risk of confusion with other relevant fields, such as psychology, while communicating the idea succinctly of what is being referred to and without being too cumbersome a term. It will suit. I have also made an attempt with this book not to offer a simple collection of visualization exercises intended to be served directly out of the can. Instead, while I do offer an example visualization or exercise from time to time, I have attempted to deliver a description of the processes involved such that you can develop and employ your own set of visualizations and techniques which are meaningful to you. It is my sincere hope that the energy worker who listens to this book will come away with a sufficient knowledge and understanding that they might be able to not only perform the exercises and methods I describe. Far more importantly, I hope that you come away from this book with an understanding that allows you to innovate and develop your own methods. A Historical Introduction to Subtle Energy. A great number of spiritual practices from around the world allude to or directly work with some kind of subtle or psychic energy or force. Though called by many names, this energy tends to behave similarly enough throughout traditions that it is possible to study it as a thing unto itself, informed by a wide variety of traditions. It is difficult to say when the practice of subtle energy manipulation became a goal or practice unto itself, but in broad strokes, it seems to be a fairly recent phenomenon. While many traditions have worked with this energy, or alluded to it, or taught about it, it is rarely the focus of a practice. More commonly, it is merely understood as either a mechanism of action, by which a ritual, spell, meditation, or so on is efficacious, or it is a means to an end, where controlling it can be used to engage in the work of spiritual alchemy, the transformation of the self into something beyond the mundane. It would be far too involved to discuss every system's understanding of subtle energy in its own terms, and to them do proper justice. However, if one wished to commit to another system to learn more about its approach to subtle energy, there are a great number of choices. Qi in the Chinese systems, as understood in the internal martial arts, or Qi in the Japanese language and its systems, including Reiki, are well-known examples of such a subtle energy. In India, there are yogic practices focusing on prana, or breath. Tibetans understand the body channels to be full of moving lung, or wind. In the scientific materialism of the Soviet Union, bioplasma was the term used to describe the proposed force by which psychokinesis was possible, and in the West, we have long used the term psi for the unknown, and psi energy became the common term to describe this, with the CIA in its research using the term psychoenergetics for the entire field. In this book, I have chosen to use the term subtle energy as a descriptive term which does not carry with it the materialistic or scientific implications of words like psychoenergy or bioplasma, nor the cultural baggage of terms like qi or lung. No matter what it's called, the general themes remain the same. Subtle energy is the vehicle by which psychic or magical effects may be achieved, and the manipulation of which is a psychic discipline unto itself. However, in all of the aforementioned traditions, this subtle energy is worked with only as a means to an end. Achieving control over it may only be important as a stepping stone to another greater result, be it physical, spiritual, or mental. Indeed, often in the pursuit of spiritual paths, abilities related to psychic phenomena are achieved as a matter of course, rather than as a deliberate goal. The yogi achieves miracle powers not by seeking the miracle powers, but by seeking enlightenment. Along this path, powers may be developed, but they are a side effect rather than the goal. This kind of secondary focus is very common among spiritual paths. Similarly, even when psychic abilities are the goal, the direct manipulation of energy is not usually the aim. In trying to develop telepathy, clairvoyance, or psychokinesis, questions about psi energy or so on might be entertained, not because there is inherent value in such energetic work, but because of the potential abilities to which it relates. Interest in manipulating subtle energy directly as its own discipline is a fairly recent development. The work with this energy in the West became very popular along with the rise of spiritualism in the 19th century, and particularly with the Theosophical Society. See, for example, Blavatsky's The Secret Doctrine, in which he expounds on her theories in great detail, including concepts of the energy body. Spiritualism developed at the cusp of, or perhaps in response to, the scientific advances of the era. As it formalized in the late 1800s, it became subject to far more rigorous analysis. A spiritual medium now had to produce fairly grand results to be taken seriously, and accusations of fraud amongst mediums outside of respected circles led to a sort of standardization in how things were proposed to work. Increasing scientific scrutiny led to some of the first real scientific investigations of psychic phenomena, as well as investigations into ghosts and spirit mediums generally, the focus of the Society for Psychical Research founded in 1882, among others. Around the same time, the Theosophical Society was founded in New York and took a heavy-handed and imperialistic approach to seeking the truth. With the objective of discovering the truth inherent in all religions, early theosophists would pick and choose concepts from other cultures and religions which supported their own notions of the truth. The idea that all spiritual practices are essentially the same, with the truths often corrupted or obscured by primitive people's cultures, led to the assimilation of a huge amount of occult knowledge from around the world into an unfortunately homogenized stew from which it became very difficult to extract any particularly useful information. It is this reckless approach that led to a great number of misunderstandings that remain persistent in the Western esoteric tradition today, such as the ubiquitous chakra model taken from a single misunderstood tantric source. C.W. Ledbetter's The Chakras, which expounds on the now generally accepted seven chakra model, was itself based on translations by Sir John Woodruff and makes assumptions based on already established Theosophical Society beliefs of the time. The dubious quality of Woodruff's translations, as well as their own unorthodox source, compounded into misunderstandings which are now considered orthodox. Despite the less than culturally sensitive approach, admittedly quite common and popular at the time, it is this aggressive search for truth by distilling the common elements of various esoteric traditions that first brought about an idea of this subtle energy being an actually existent and important thing. After all, if so many cultures have ideas for this, then surely there must be something there. Ultimately, spiritualism lost popularity as an increase in pressure on mediums to give a good performance brought the focus off of spirit communication, which is, to be fair, usually quite boring, and onto the manifestation of physical results, which in turn forced even possibly legitimate mediums to commit fraud in order to guarantee customers. The uncovering of physical mediums as frauds brought a great deal of criticism on the spiritualist movement. At the same time, the Theosophical Society, which had never been a large movement to begin with, but always a focus primarily of esotericists, also began to wane in popularity. It did not do well through the tumult of the two world wars, but never fully vanished. Indeed, the Theosophical Society still exists today, and is quite healthy as these things go. Instead, teachings about ascended masters were superseded by Aleister Crowley's Thelema in the popular magic of the time, or later merged into the various UFO cults of the 70s, 80s, and 90s. The New Age movement served as, if not a direct successor, at least a spiritual one. With the New Age movement, the currency of the esoteric gained some traction again. Now, with a greater exposure to information from other traditions, once again people sought to find what they were missing, approaching the occult with a renewed interest. Psychicism, magic, and so on were all back in vogue. As it popularized, however, the spirituality was not always well preserved, and people became more interested in the affectations than the effect. Along with the U.S. military taking an interest at this time in psychic abilities, the shift from spiritual to practical reflected the spirit of the time. Project Center Lane, Stargate, Grill Flame, and others investigated psychic phenomena, primarily with a focus on remote viewing and psychokinesis, and in response to Russian and Chinese research into the same. Much of this research has been made available through the Freedom of Information Act and is available on the CIA website. While parapsychology had always had an interest in the scientific investigation of psychic phenomena, these investigations historically did not attend to untestable notions of psychic energy, but instead focused on observable phenomena like telepathy or psychokinesis. Subtle energy manipulation was now no longer a side effect of spiritual attainment, but an ability to be sought after on its own, or as a mechanism by which one could develop the more concrete abilities. A Philosophical Introduction to Subtle Energy. What, then, is subtle energy? It is, in essence, a vaguely defined force or energy which seems to be directed by mental will and which can be used to affect material reality. The term energy is only by convention. It is not energy in the sense used in physics, a property by which matter is heated or performs work. It cannot to date be measured technologically, and so for this reason, it is better to use the spiritual model rather than the materialistic scientific model to work with it. This energy can be employed for a variety of reasons, including communication with others, protecting oneself from the psychic impressions of the environment, reproducing magical effects, or interacting with the physical environment or with living things. Direct energy manipulation is also frequently employed in the astral planes, where it seems much more effective generally. The uses of subtle energy in its direct form are myriad, because it is, in essence, a method of directing will and a mechanism by which that will can take form. Adherents of this kind of magical work tend to focus on very direct and immediate results, with increased complexity taking increased work and generally branching into other fields at that point. Chaos magicians often find themselves quite comfortable with this kind of work, While ceremonial magicians often deride the practices as ineffective or inferior in their possible results. Generally, however, the goal of the ritualist is not the same as the goal of the energy worker. If a solitary difference had to be pointed out, it might be that the ritualist performs the rituals such that some external force brings about the result, while the energy worker aims to do the work him or herself. By doing so, the energy worker may have more immediate control or agency in the work, but also likely has significantly less power to bring it about. Subtle energy manipulation is generally first learned by developing skill in visualization and meditation. Meditation can help calm our minds and the distractions that come from the conventional senses, making one more sensitive to the subtle movements of energy within and around the body. This meditation does not need to be strict or formal at first, but a strong meditative practice makes for an easier time going forward, in addition to being beneficial just generally in one's life. The skill of visualization goes together with meditation. Visualization is distinct from imagination because visualization is intended to be efficacious. That is, we visualize a result we actually intend to create by way of the visualization. Imagining something moving and visualizing something moving are different actions because the visualization is an intended or desired outcome. Consider an archer with a bow and arrow taking aim at a target. Anyone can imagine twanging a bow and the arrow hitting the target, but when the archer visualizes the arrow hitting the target, he or she puts into motion the events to see it happen. The visualization directs the body what to do, and the body then does it. Similarly, by visualizing the movement of energy, we do not simply imagine it there, but rather intend it and so direct it. Similarly, when we visualize a ball of energy forming or visualize energy flowing to or from something, we are not pretending this is happening, but rather, the act of visualization and the intent for it to be happening does in fact put the energy in motion. With greater levels of mental concentration and clearer, undistracted visualization, we are able to move this energy with greater precision and strength, and so it becomes more effective. To this end, we find ourselves back at meditation, where the ability to still the mind until distracting thoughts are reduced benefits our concentration and so the effectiveness of our work. The way that subtle energy is believed to work, where it originates, what its properties are, and so on, are tied heavily to cultural traditions that recognize it and work with it, and so can be learned in much greater detail through the lens of a tradition that supports it. There is no single traditional understanding which transcends all cultural practices which have acknowledged it, though there are variations on themes. Because it defies the materialistic investigation of modern science, it cannot be described definitively outside the traditions in which its practice has been developed. Ultimately, it is not so important what its objective scientific properties are, if it even has any at all, but rather what its subjective experiential qualities are. Because it is directed by mind, because it affects mind, and is affected by mind, it is more important that our understanding of subtle energy be internally consistent rather than externally correspondent to some kind of dogma. I will attempt here to describe the framework and model of subtle energy work that works for me. I make no attempt to declare it the only truth or some absolute truth, but rather it is the model by which I have come to understand this subtle energy through my experience and study. While I believe this model is strong and leads to good results in working with energy, I do not mean to promote it as the only model or even as the best model for you. Still, I think it's a good enough framework to enable instruction and inquiry without discouraging learning. The world, this phenomenal reality we all share, can be conceived of as divisible into three spheres or domains existing in relation to one another without being entirely distinct or entirely separate. Listen to Appendix B on Hermetic philosophy for an esoteric philosophy which employs this model and from which much of the model presented in this book is extrapolated. It is not the only or first system to use this model, but it is one of the more prominent. These three spheres, planes, or realms can be graded in rank from coarse to subtle, the material or physical plane, the astral or energetic plane, and the mental or spiritual plane. The material plane needs very little explanation, as it is the physical world in which we all reside. It is the realm of books, tables, chairs, and people with physical, fleshy bodies. It is very coarse because it is conditioned by its own material nature. Because it is so coarse, it is easy to interact with through actually physical means, and much more difficult to interact with through subtle means. Bang two rocks together and you get an immediate result. Run water over a rock and you still get a result, but it takes much longer. If you want to use the water to interact with the rock in the same way as you did when you banged two rocks together, it's going to take some know-how. The use of subtle energy in the physical world is like this too. A skilled use can bring about some kind of an effect, but it may just as well be better to use a physical tool. The astral plane or energetic world is subtler, but not entirely subtle. It is a kind of consensus reality of minds. The astral reflects the world sometimes, but it is hazy, like a density in disturbed water. Powerful objects in the physical world reflect through, but objects of less consequence do not. The astral plane is additionally the domain of many spirits who may have difficulty communicating in the physical world, but can do so easily there. The astral does not correspond with the physical world in a one-to-one way, and because it is subtler, it is much more easily influenced by our minds. Whereas in the material world, it is difficult for our minds to manifest dramatic results, in the astral, this is not so difficult at all. Astral projection has long been a practice of ceremonial magicians and energy workers alike, as both are able to more easily communicate with and interact with spirits there, as well as to work spells and manifest the results they wish to see reflected down on the material plane. The mental plane is the most fickle and pernicious, and it is subtler still. Here, our ability to concentrate is very important as the mental plane's subtlety allows it to be affected by mere thought. It is, in essence, an abstraction of our own minds and as fickle and subject to change as our thoughts are from moment to moment. Here is the place of ideas and concepts that we hold, not held together strongly by consensus, but rather subject to whimsy and distraction. We also interact with the mental plane through perception of the astral and the physical planes. The act of perception is a mental one. Whereas sensation occurs through a physical process and a sensory organ, perception is a process of cognition. What we sense with our eyes, for example, provides mental information which we process, coming up with what we think or feel about a thing. In a constant loop of cognition, we gain new information, and based on that information, we change our opinions or apply them to the objects we are sensing. This overlay, originating from our own minds, is the substance of the mental plane. Indeed, the three planes described here are in truth not entirely distinct one from another.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.